Hi, this is Larry London. We welcome you to Border Crossings. And today from Los Angeles, we are joined by an artist who has taken over the radio. 300 million streams. The guy started with TikTok and it just exploded with Put Your Records On. And now he's got a new song as well. We'd like to welcome to the Voice of America and to our worldwide audience, Ritt Momney. It's great to have you, Ritt Momney.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Now, let me ask you this first basic question. How does Jack Rutter become Ritt Momney?
So it kind of started out as a band that I started with some of my friends in high school. The idea was kind of to be like kind of an indie rock kind of band. Most of those people in the band went on LDS missions, like Mormon missions. Mm-hmm. And my girlfriend at the time, who was in the band, went to college. So I was kind of just alone with the opportunity to put music out under Ritt Momney, because I'd always kind of been like the writer and stuff. Mm-hmm. So I felt like I could kind of take the name and like run with it.
And it's obviously a tongue-in-cheek play on a actual politician from where you're from Utah. And so, I mean, does this mean that you're a funny guy? You're a sarcastic kind of guy? Who is Ritt Momney?
I think sometimes it gives that impression, even though that's not necessarily true. I try to be funny sometimes. I kind of like the contrast between a lot of the music that I write. Like, besides the cover, a lot of my music is pretty sad and like pretty dark. So there's kind of that contrast there. Like, wow, what a ridiculous name for this kind of music.
When you were in high school, you were actually really more into rock and that sound. And now I understand that you're kind of struggling, or at least coming to grips with the pop world and the success that you had.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's been kind of weird there's obviously like a bunch of pressure to keep this like going, like, okay, now we have like a window of opportunity to blow this thing open and like become a huge pop star. Even though that's not like, I don't really, I kind of like making less poppy music, I think. And there's definitely I'm not above those like temptations of making something I don't want to make. Mm-hmm. For the sake of like money and fame. But that's something I've been battling recently.
Is it a business? It becomes a real struggle. Totally.
And I think every artist kind of needs to choose where on that spectrum they want to go. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, I think if anybody chooses 100% business, like it's like you might as well be like working a desk job. So yeah, that's been something that I've been trying to deal with. Obviously, like it's important to remind myself though, like this is the coolest thing ever. And like, mm-hmm. Yes. Even if the majority of the Put Your Records On fans don't like the stuff that I put out next, like,
right.
Then like, there's still way more people listening to it, even just one time than there would be otherwise. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely a cool opportunity. I'm trying not to, I went through a phase where it was like, okay, like it was totally influencing like what I was writing. Like for like a month after the song like kind of blew up, I was like, okay, like I need to bring in some more of these elements now because like people need to like recognize me as this guy. And and it was just like not everything I made in that phase just sucked.
Right, right.
Girl, put your records on. Tell me your favorite song. It got with lay your head down. Sapphire faded jeans. I hope you get your dream. Let's go ahead, let your head down. You're gonna find yourself somewhere, somehow.
It's got to be. I mean, it is a big challenge to come to terms with who Ritt Momney is and what your comfort zone is. But yeah. The being versatile, being, you know, able to reach many different peoples in all kinds of genres. Music is music. Great music, you know, the universal language, as they say. So you've managed to touch a lot of different people. The question is, why did you pick Put Your Records On?
That was, I settled on that right after. So the pandemic hit, like the tour that I was going to go on got canceled. And it was like, I was in the middle of like writing this like sad, depressing music, just cause that's like kind of where my mind goes mostly when it comes to music. And I was just like, oh man, like there's too much of that feeling like in me and like in the entire world right now. Like I can't even handle that, and I felt like I would be faking it if I tried to write like a happy song, and then I heard that song, I heard Put Your Records On again for the first time in a really long time, and I was like, and I'd always loved it, like my mom loved the song and played it all the time when I was a kid, and it was just kind of one of those songs that is like always gonna be like with you. And I was like, I love the feeling that this song is giving me, like, it'd be cool to just have some fun with this song. Mm-hmm.
Does Corinne Bailey Ray, I mean, obviously she's heard it. She knows it exists. Have you been connected with her at all? Has she said anything?
Yeah. I was on a Zoom call with her a few months ago and it was awesome. It was like the coolest thing ever. And she was so nice. Like exactly what you would expect from somebody who wrote that song. I was so impressed with her. Mm-hmm. And it was really cool to talk to her about we kind of had the same experience with the same exact song where we were kind of like doing like the indie thing and then this song, Put Your Records On, like for both of us, like threw us into this like pop world. Mm-hmm.
And you're now with a major label too, and so that was also her story, you know, and that, yeah. There's a big change going from the indie world to the majors.
Yeah, totally. And we talked a lot about that, and that was I was still kind of in that phase of just like trying to of like part of me trying to recreate the Put Your Records On stuff and make sure like I capitalize on the success of that song, and I was feeling kind of like down about that, and she was like yeah, I get that feeling, like you just really need to do what like feels right to you and mm-hmm. do like make what you feel like you want to make.
That's great. That's great advice. And yet your version of the song started a whole trend on TikTok where everybody started to post their version or doing something with your yeah. song. And I guess over 1.5 million people posted video clips.
Yeah, it was crazy. It was happening pretty quick too. There was a makeup trend that a guy named Ian started. And that like, I probably would not be here talking to you if that wasn't a thing. So
right.
It's crazy how TikTok has such a crazy influence on the music industry today.
Mm-hmm. Well, literally, you have become an overnight sensation in the literal sense. And so life changes, the pressure changes, everything changes. And so many stars have been victims of their own fame and the pressure mm-hmm. that came. You're only 21, I guess you're still 21. And so this is, very early to be handling all of this, all these demands and all of this fame. And yet at the same time, you really haven't felt it because you've been isolated. We're in this virtual world.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that's right. It has been a lot of internet opinions that I've been reading and not very much like actually talking to people, which has been kind of hard. But I mean, I think a lot of people will just like, or some stories you hear about, like people just try out music for like the first time and then that song like that they tried out with just like blows up, and then it's like they don't really have like a foundation to start from, and then that's when like the label can come in and just like completely control and like create that artist's whole career.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad that this didn't happen like 3 years ago when I was like kind of getting started with like releasing my own music, and I kind of already have an idea of like what I want to do and how I want to make music. So I'm like fortunate for that.
So I want to find out about this next song. You kind of touched on the fact that a lot of people are going to be surprised. It's going to be different. Not Around is the name of the new single. What's the vibe? What's the story behind the new song, Not Around?
Yeah, it's about kind of sensing. It's a pretty like a standard relationship song, and kind of like sensing like something's off between us. And then it kind of starts out with like that feeling, like I can tell something's off, like something weird is going on. And then it's like more and more contention, but then it comes back to like, well, when you're not around, like everything sucks. So like we need to stay together. Kind of just the standard relationship, like back and forth between like, mm-hmm. oh, something weird is going on, but like I really don't want to lose you, kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. It's going to have a rock vibe to it, a rock feel.
Yeah, at the end, like it goes into this like very rock, like a solo, like epic guitar kind of thing, which is cool. It's a definitely different vibe from I'd Put Your Records On, but. Mm-hmm.
And you're coming out with a new album as well here this year. So mm-hmm. how does the new album differ, or does it differ from Her and All My Friends, your first album from a couple of years ago?
Yeah, I think if you were to listen through Her and All My Friends, like chronologically, like you can really hear me, like as in like the songs that I did first and then the songs that I did later. Like I really felt like I was kind of finding my voice like throughout that album. Like I was working on some of those songs for like 2.5 years or something before they finally ended up on the album. And now like that album was kind of more of like a culmination of me like becoming a musician. And now I feel like I have more of like a footing, and I can kind of start and finish something in more of like a deliberate place.
You had mentioned that you do a number of sad songs or relationships. Will that album be that way? And
it's that same feeling. I'm trying to, like, Her and All My Friends was pretty pretty sad without even any, like, redeeming, like, it was kind of just, like, sad and that's it in a lot of ways. But kind of in life and in, like, my writing, I've been thinking a lot more about, like, Okay, well, like what, like let's not just like wallow in the sadness. Like what lessons can we learn? And like,
right.
Like, so I think this next album will be a lot of kind of the sad stuff, but kind of with like I'm kind of trying to work through the sadness with some kind of like message. And like, I'm trying to find that out for myself and trying to find it out so all my songs aren't just depressing for no reason.
When you wrote for yourself before, it's one style of writing. You're just pleasing yourself. Mm-hmm. Writing now, because you've gotten famous, there's a certain responsibility, and you now are a role model. You now become an influential person to mm-hmm. other people, young people. So the message is, you know, received differently. You have to think of them as well as how it's received and whatnot. But mm-hmm. I guess music is therapeutic to you. It sounds in a little way, you know, writing these songs lets you express yourself and some of your thoughts.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of like writing in a journal in a lot of ways. Like it's hard for me to organize my thoughts if I'm not like writing songs about them. And yeah, I mean it is really therapeutic, like for me to write. And I hope I can kind of help people in the same mindset as me. So yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, your music is so far well received. People are really, you know, very interested in knowing you better. And so this is an opportunity. We're broadcasting to 100 countries around the world. And so people are getting to meet you for the first time. They've heard your music. And so do you have a name for the next album or thought about a name, release date?
I don't have a name or a release date yet. Like it's still coming along for sure. Mm. It should definitely still be out in 2021. But yeah, I'm still working on it. But yeah.
Well, great. I mean, you know, when your album does come out, hopefully, you know, this pandemic situation clears rather quickly. We seem to be nearing the end. And you come to Washington, I'd love to have you in the studio. We could talk more and figure out, you know, what the journey is of the new album, where you ended up with it. And I'd love to follow up with you. You're a very talented guy, very talented songwriter and performer as well.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, no, thank you so much for joining us. I know that you've got a busy press day today, one after another, but I thank you for being a part of the Voice of America and our show Border Crossings. Ritt Momney is our guest. And put your records on. He's the man. He's the guy. And continued success to you, Ritt Momney. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
This is Border Crossings. You're watching The Voice of America.